Hi, AP music theory exam, right? Multiple choice, part A, the listening part. Do you find that intimidating? So honestly, I locked myself up in a room in over spring break and took an old AP exam. And that's the part of the exam that I had, you know, some trouble, being honest. So here's the thing, in a 45 minute session, we can't go over every concept, every term, that you might encounter, but what we can do is show you what kinds of questions you might expect and in what sequence. So, because if you know what's coming, you know, even though you might get a little frazzled, if you know what's coming, you go, oh yeah, that's the thing that guy was talking about, and you can stay calm and reason through these things better. Okay, so let's go. Boom. What will we learn? Okay, so Dr. Eder yesterday went over this with you, the format of the AP music theory exam. When the exam starts, the first thing you do is multiple choice, and the first half of that is aural, listening. Now this line here is a little bit misleading. All of the multiple choice combined is 45% of the test. Today we're just talking about this much. Okay, so today's tasks, we're going to start every one of these sessions with some singing, because you know, so on the test, singing doesn't happen till the end, right? But really, in music, singing is what links the ear to the brain. We should sing every day. If we sing better, of course, we're going to sing better, but we're also training our ear. We can hear better. We can answer these aural questions better. We can do dictations better. So that's why we do that. Okay. And then we're going to get right into it. Multiple choice has these question types. And just to save time, I'm just going to put that up. We're going to spend plenty of time on each of these sections. Okay, sections. All right, here we go. I found a second trumpet player and improved that fanfare. Inspired by my friends at Central Bucks West High School in Doylestown, Pennsylvania. Yeah, so here we go, warm-up singing. What I'm gonna do today, you know that you have 75 seconds to practice. By the way, in 2019, what Dr. Eder showed you yesterday, this wording suddenly became 1 minute, 15 seconds. Don't freak out. Same thing, I almost put minutes. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna flash the melody, and I'm gonna spend 75 seconds, kind of model what you might do. And maybe you could do it with me, or you could do your own thing. If you wanna do your own thing, just go ahead and mute. I have a little 75 second timer here. When the image is done, that's 75 seconds. So here's what I would do. Ready, set, go. Now, they give you do, or first note, do, bass clef. 2 flat, starts on B flat. Also, no accidentals. This isn't a major key. So I would go, do, follow me, do, re, mi, fa, re, mi, fa, sol, la. A lot of scale stuff. La, sol, la, ti, do. Here's the jumps. Do, so, mi, fa, mi, re, do, do, this part here. Do, so, mi, maybe backwards. Mi, so, do, do, so, mi. If you do numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6, 5, 6, 7, 1, 5, 3, 4, 3, 2, 1. My timer's still going. I still have time. Do, re, mi, fa, re, mi, fa, so, la. La, sol, la, ti, do, so, mi, fa, mi, re, do. Do, re, mi, fa, and my time's up. The point being, during the 75 seconds, I am actively singing. If you're like me, if you can sing this 3, 4, 5 times, it might take a little longer to figure it out, right? I cheated because I studied this before. What was I saying? If you're like me, if your recording is the 4th, 3rd, 4th, 5th times that you actually sing this, you're going to sound better than if it's the first time. Don't sit in silence and stare at the music. These are sounds, they're not dots. So let's sing this together. 6, 8. 1 and 2 and go. Do, re, mi, fa, re, mi, fa, sol, la. La, sol, la, ti, do, so, mi, fa, mi, re, do. Off. Full value on the last note. Hey, I should probably not have given you the starting note before the recording time, right? You just get it at the beginning. You can take that starting note or you can make your own. All right, so that's the first melody of 2017. We all know from yesterday that if the first melody is major, the second one is minor, so we know what to expect. If the first one is bass clef, the second one is going to be in treble clef. If the first one is in a compound meter, 6/8, the second one is going to be in simple meter, right? So we have some expectations of what we're going to see. So here we go. You can write down solfege scale degrees if you want. Some, you know, it might be a good idea. Just if you do that, though, practice doing that, because 75 seconds goes faster when you're writing. Okay, here's the second melody, starting note. I know it's minor already before I start. And also there are key signatures, right? Do, ti, do, re, me. Well, that's kind of friendly so far. Do, ti, do, re, me. Sol, le, sol, le, so, fa, fi, so. Fa, fi, so. I use do bass minor. Sol, la, ti, do, te, le, so, ti, do. Or if you're a La bass minor speaker, La, Si, La, Ti, Do, Mi, Fa, Mi, Re, Ri, Mi, Mi, Fi, Si, La, So, Fa, Mi, Si, La. Or if you're a scale degree person, 1, 7, 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 5, 4, sharp 5. 5 6 7 1 7 6 5 7 1, and my time is almost up. Do ti do, you know what? Yeah, do ti do re me so le so fa fi so. There's my time. I sang it probably 3.5 times. Do that. If you get stuck, hey, don't do the thing where you go do ti do re me so, do ti do re me so, do ti do re me so. Because you're going to get really good at that. Do, ti, do, re, me. You will not have got to the last part. So try to get to the end. If you have a hard part, just skip. Maybe come back to that later, right? So this time I'm not going to give do. I'm not 100% sure. I'm still in pitch here, in key. Do, do, ready. 1, 2, 3, 4. Do, ti, do, re, me. Sol, le, so, fa, fi, so. So la ti do te le so ti do. Now, right? Dr. Eater said something yesterday. If I'm not, maybe I was a little low. So la ti do. If that's too high, you don't have to sing it there, right? You just pick a do. I don't know. Let's try that. Do, go. Do, ti, do, re, me, sol, le, so, fa, fi, so. Or I'll switch to mi, fi, si, la, so, fa, mi, si, la. That kind of thing, okay? I'm going to say, though, singing is one of those things that you get better incrementally. Do it every day. If you haven't been, you know, you should be doing it every day. Every day. Every day. Okay, so back to the program here, or on to the program, I guess. So we're going to talk about multiple choice, part A. Before we do, though, how is an AP exam different from a test you might take during the school year? So this is an important point. If you take a test in my class, I know what I've covered. I know what I've taught. I know what you should have learned. I actually know what's on the test because I probably made the test or I've seen the test, right? So if you prepare properly, there's no reason you couldn't get, you know, perfect scores. Perfect scores happen in my classes. But an AP exam works different. And this is true of all subjects, right? They give you like this. That's your task. Nobody is expecting you. There are very, very few perfect scores, if ever, on music theory. Your job on that day is to show them like how much of this that you can get, right? The expectation is not this. So as you take a test, you know, and that's hard for students, AP type students, where, you know, we want to get it all. You have to be okay with not getting it all. You have to be okay with just doing your best, staying calm, being reasoning through things, right? That's hard. That's a mindset change. What are some of the challenges of this section of the AP exam? So compared to free response questions, the questions cover a wide variety of topics. So say, for example, part writing, figure base. Yes, there's a lot to remember, right? It's tough. There's a lot to remember, but you know what you're going to get. They say, okay, there's going to be a figure base question on the test. I'll study figure base. I'll learn it. You know, the questions come from anywhere. I call this the proverbial box of chocolates. I actually freehand drew that, right? Box of chocolate. You don't know. I hope you know that reference, right? You don't know what you're going to get. The other thing is, compared to like a regular multiple choice test, you don't control, like on a regular test, you can look at the kind of peruse the test and say, oh, this one's easy. This one's easy. I'll do this one. I'll come back to this one. You can't do this because there's a recording and you have to go in the order of the recording for the most part. And not only that, you don't control how long you hear this, or you don't control how long you get to study the music. The recording goes, oh, here's the recording. Boom. You got to go. This to me is very unnerving. This to me is like watching TV with somebody, you know, somebody else has the remote control and you have no control over what's happening on the screen. That's kind of frustrating for some personality types. That's what it feels like. That was my moment. The thing is, this is the first thing you do on the AP exam. AP exam is like a marathon. It's a long thing. Just whatever happens, don't get rattled. That's my metaphor. Don't get rattled. And if you find yourself getting frustrated, just have this mental image of a grown man freehand drawing a rattle and then going through the junk bin and finding a rattle and recording it for the sake of a metaphor. And just have a chuckle and go, oh yeah, that guy, right? Just stay calm. You'll be okay. All right. On the plus side, there are no penalty for wrong answers. So if you're not sure, guess. And you might be, okay, this is a random guess, but your guesses are founded on being a musician for how many ever years you've been a musician, and also for having studied AP music for a year, right? Intense stuff. And this is one other thing. How are these questions different from how you see them in AP classroom? If you've been practicing multiple choice questions in AP classroom, which is a great resource, there are a few things that are different. I'll print them or point them out as I go. I'll point them out as I go. It's just these questions happen in sets, and you don't get to see the big picture sometimes in AP classroom. All right, so here we go. Multiple choice, somewhere between 41 and 43, the listening questions. Every year, the first 8 questions are what we call discrete questions. So we'll take a look at a few of those. First 6 have to do with pitch. We did these in my class today. And 7 and 8 are rhythm patterns. And then questions go into sets, right? This is where AP classroom, you're seeing one question at a time. You don't see sets. So strategies change a little bit. There is also always a 4 question set where they play piano music, and then you have to find the errors. Okay, so we'll see a set of that. The main bulk, the meat of the test, is the contest, or this portion of the test, contextual listening set. So they play musical excerpts, this clip, and then you have to answer questions on that. That is where the proverbial box of chocolates comes, right? Remember the old guy freehanding this. If you zoom in, can I zoom in? Do I have time to do that? I don't at least, okay. See, there's a treble clef chocolate there, trumpet chocolate. We go to great lengths here. Okay, as my students would know. And now my PowerPoint stuck. All right. Okay. So we're going to start with this discrete questions. Let's take a look at an example. Okay. Questions 1 through 6. Well, we'll have
questions
the professional
one through
read
six
it.
Ask you to identify pitch patterns that are played. In each case, the question number will be announced. You will have 10 seconds to read the choices, and then you will hear the musical example played twice, with a brief pause between playings. Remember to read the choices for each question after its number is announced. Now listen to the music for questions 1 through 6 and identify the pitch patterns that are played.
Now these are covered pretty well in AP Classroom, and I hope you're using that as a resource. The important thing is here, you have 10 seconds to read the choices. You're gonna hear silence. You're gonna hear silence? I don't know. You know what I mean. In that time, don't stare at the wall, right? Read the music. That's the busiest time. So here's an example. You have 10 seconds to study this. I am going to go look at all of this and say, okay, there's a whole step. This is a half step. Now I'm going up. These sound like major thirds. These sounds like minor or big picture. I might go, okay, here's my major scale. I know what major sounds like. This one starts with a half step, but now this one sounds like our regular minor scale, maybe harmonic because of this, right? Harmonic. Excuse the scribbling. This one has a major third, but like a te or lowered seven. Well, that's my, if you've studied modes, if you got to that part, that's my mixolydian. And this one is natural minor, spelled with a M. Okay. M for natural minor. Natural, well, that's much better, isn't it? Or Dorian, actually, it could be, because there's no scale degree six. So if you could do any of that in the 10 seconds, just don't stay, you know, inactive. That's very active brain time. Try to hear this stuff, because then you know you have something to expect. If you have expectations in your ear, in your head, and then when you hear something, you know which one it is. So I don't know if you remember, this is DJ Kitty. We got him in August. Here we are in April. He doesn't look like that anymore. If he was like a real kid, he's like, oh, why are you using my baby picture? But too bad.
Pitch pattern played twice.
And then you'll hear it again. That's the sound of the major scale. So I'm going to go D. But the thing is, the recording goes on now. You don't get to go, oh, if I can just hear it one more time, or if I just had another 2 seconds to look. You don't get to. Oh, there's that guy. See, that's what I'm talking about. So this is the remote control thing. You just have to go with it, make your best go at it, and move on. Okay, that's a melodic set. They also have harmonic sets. This is two notes, but sometimes, like today, we did one where we had to hear four notes. Right. Here we go. So analysis, I might say, okay, that's a third. Thirds are kind of consonant. That's a fourth. That's a fifth. Fourth, fifth. This is a perfect fifth. That's a very open sound. The sound of a perfect four and a perfect fifth are fairly similar. This is the one that's in between. It's the augmented fourth. So of all the ones, this is going to sound dissonant. So I'm going to say pleasing, open, maybe open, and dissonant. If you could do that in 10 seconds, you're good. Okay, DJ Kitty, go.
Pitch pattern played twice.
Right, and here's the discrete part that's kind of strange. It's like kind of like a spelling bee, like, okay, you know how to spell a word, good for you kind of thing. If we can do this and then put it in context, now there's function to what we heard, and that makes a lot more sense. Anyway, it was the dissonant one. C was the answer. C was the answer. If you found that hard, don't get rattled. Think of a grown man drawing a rattle. Freehand. Okay. And that's not version one, by the way. See, we go to great length. Okay. Question 7 and 8. So there are six, we just saw two, but there are six questions that deal with pitch. Some are harmonic, some are melodic. There are two questions that deal with rhythms, and these tend to go a little bit better. You get to study these two. When you see the choices, you'll see that all the notes are the same. The rhythms are different, and that's what they're asking you to discern. That's a good word, discern. Okay, so a couple minutes to study that. I might sing that in my head. Dum, da, da, dum, dum, like that. DJ Kitty. So
rhythm pattern played twice.
Ba da 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 dee dee dum. See, hey. While that was playing, I remembered something, because we got it to a hasty start there. Hey, anywhere along the way, if you have any questions or comments, feedback, check out that tiny URL, and then just drop me a note. I will do my best to read all of these. Yeah. Okay. All three of them, maybe. Okay. Don't get rattled. These rhythm ones tend to go pretty well. Okay. So that is the first section, 8 discrete questions. This is the first things you do, and it's kind of, for me, kind of unnerving. I'm hardly ever sure, is this the absolute right answer? Some of them I will be, but if it's not, it's okay, right? The whole thing I said about the AP exams, you don't have to get all of them. It's okay. Now we go into the question set. Now, these are not in order. The first set is not necessarily a piano error detection set, but let's look at these. So I think of all the error ones, the question sets, these are the ones that's probably most practicable. You could be preparable. So let's look at an example, and I have to go off. Oh, that's not the example I need. This is the example I need. Okay, so questions 20 to 23 are based on an excerpt that will be played 4 times. You'll notice it's a grand staff, left hand, right hand. So this is piano music, right? The score is printed correctly below, but in the version you will hear several measures contain errors in either pitch or rhythm. Before listening to the music for the first time, please read questions. So reading the questions is important. So when I first did a question set like this, you know, I try to be like a normal real life musician, and I try to hear all of it. And I'll go, oh, I heard an error here. I heard an error here. And by the time I got to here, I got bad, but I didn't know I got rattled. I got rattled. But with a little strategy and staying calm, important. This set is not too bad, I think. Okay. So in a real life music situation, you're checking everything, right? Go, oh, there's something. This is a test situation. You don't need to listen to every measure. Why? It tells you where the errors are, right? So what I would do is I would go, okay, the question says I need to listen to these measures. And this is where it's a little different than AP Classroom, because you don't get to see this in a set. You'll see this excerpt, and then you'll see one question. So strategy is a little different, okay? Which means this is a very amusical thing to say right now, right? But this is an exam situation. These measures, other than maybe to set up the other measures, don't really pertain to the question. You don't really listen to them very carefully. We do these in class, and we play the whole thing, and I always ask, what kind of cadence did you hear? You know, and the good students go, well, that's a perfect authentic cadence. But the real answer I'm looking for is, I have no idea, because I didn't listen to that measure, right? Not musical. This is test prep. Okay, here's the thing. Each measure contains a rhythm or pitch error, right? And you hear this 4 times. Now, if you're a pianist and you grew up, you've been playing piano for many years, maybe you can hear 2 clefs at the same time. I grew up a trumpet player. I'm kind of learning piano now. I hear one line better than the other, or one line at a time better than the other. So you're going to hear this 4 times. I'm going to concentrate my first 2 hearings on my favorite clef. If you play cello, it might be the bass clef, right? And then as I go, okay, the rhythms are always pitch or rhythm. I'm just going to go, oh, I heard a pitch error here. And that's what I might get the first time. But you know what? The second time, you don't have to listen to that measure anymore. It really does. It's right, because you found it, and there's only one error. It's not like A and B, but not C. It's one error, right? And then second time, I'm going to stay with the treble clef, and I go, oh, rhythm. That's an R. Okay, and then third and fourth times, okay, I'm going to switch my attention over here. And then I go, okay, I don't have to listen to these. I'm just listening here. I go, ooh, I don't know, rhythm. Fourth time, pitch. And then you're done. And then you figure out, okay, what did I say? Rhythm, treble, clef, rhythm equals A, and answer it that way. Stay calm. This is not that bad. Okay, here's what we're going to do. I am going to play this right now. Remember, in an exam situation, you get to hear this 4 times. I'm going to play it once. I'd like you to work through it. But I'm going to play it once, and I'd like you to pause the recording and maybe go back a few seconds and play it again. I'm going to keep this live stream going. I'm going to keep talking. We're going to go over the answers. But if you don't want to hear the answers, pause the recording after the after you hear the music. So here is the... Oh, I'm sorry. One last thing. My students hate when I do that because they're ready to go. One last thing. Before listening to the music for the first time, please read. They give you time to read. That's when I'm going, okay, do, mi, fa, do, mi, so, la, one, two, three, four, and I'm trying to hear this thing as much as I can. I might not know the tonic, you know, I don't have perfect pitch, but you build an expectation for what you're going to hear. When you hear something else, go, oh, that's the error. Okay. So here's the music. If I can cue it right, I didn't mean to do it this way. Here we go.
First time.
Okay, here we go. Ready?
First time. Please read questions 20 through 23 and...
Okay, wrong place. Here we go.
Answer questions 20 through 23.
Okay, you get time in between. I'm going to play it one more time. So, because if you pause, I don't want you to see the answer part. So, one more time. Okay, so you get two more hearings, pause and rewind and check that out. I'm going to move ahead with the answers. What was the cadence? Okay. First measure, what I heard was the bass clef, they played four quarter notes. So the error was in bass clef rhythm, right? So whatever bass staff rhythm, whatever that translates to, B, right? Third measure, I hope that maybe you heard that these notes are the same, whether you heard the actual pitches or not. It's written mi, la, so, fi, so, but they went mi, so, fi, so. So that's a pitch error. Measure five, what I heard was, again, two quarter notes at the end. The rhythm errors tend to be friendlier, right? Measure seven might have been tricky. Is in the bass, they actually played these notes backwards. So they, instead of going down here, la, fa, so, do, they went fa, la, so, do. So they're actually two errors, two pitches. Okay, so then you translate them to your answers A, B, C, D. Usually, I don't remember these being scrambled. I think they were friendlier than that. Trouble. Pitch, treble, rhythm. It might, I don't know. You can read. We can read. Okay. So back to the program. Back to the program. Error detection. Four sets. That's very predictable. These are in AP Classroom. The only thing I said is strategy-wise, you don't get them, you don't get to see them as a set. You see them as individual questions. So just keep that in mind when you practice those. And also in AP Classroom, you get to press play. You control when and how many times you hear it. On the exam, they just play. There's a silent, how many ever seconds, play, silence. Okay, here we go. So oh, are we rattled yet? I'm getting rattled. This is rattle. I made it. I want to use it. Now I'm getting tired of it already. Here we are, 30 minutes in. Okay, the bulk of this section, approximately 30, you know, whatever adds up to these, is contextual listening. And this is where the proverbial box of chocolates, we really don't know where these questions are coming from. It might be one thing your teacher said one day in October on a Friday afternoon that kind of went out this year, and maybe some of it stayed in there somewhere. Those kind of things, right? Again, Nobody's expecting you to get all of them. Don't get rattled. If you do, just pick, close your eyes, picture this. Everything's okay. Everything's okay. All right. Let's look at an example of a set. Oh, so I'm back here and we just finished with that one. So now I do that one. Okay. Let's see. This is the first one we're going to do. I'd like us to go ahead and every one of these, the narrator reads the instructions. I'd like us for us to kind of listen to them once. Let's see if I can get this right.
Questions 9 through 13 are based on an excerpt from an orchestral piece. The first section of the excerpt will be played once. Then the entire excerpt will be played twice. Before listening to the first section, please read questions 9 and 10.
Anybody catch something funny? I caught a typo on an AP exam. This right there, 9 and 10. Okay, hey, a lot of people just kind of glaze over. They don't really pay attention to this part, but there are so many clues here. Okay, maybe not this set as much. Like we were doing a set the other day in our class. It says this is based on an excerpt for violin and harpsichord. And there was a texture question, right? And so before even listening to the music, violin and harpsichord, well, you know, monophony, probably unlikely, you know, that kind of thing. That's important. This is for orchestral piece, so it's instrumental, probably. The first section of the excerpt will be played once. Then the entire excerpt will be played twice. Before listening to the first, please read 9 to 10 is what the narrator said, even though it's printed 9 to 13. So this pertains to whatever they call the first section, okay? And then before listening to the entire excerpt for the first time, this pertains to the entire excerpt. Entire excerpt is going to include this. Sometimes they play section 1, section 2, and then the entire section. But this is where you don't get to see questions in this format in AP Classroom. And it, you know, unless you're in person, it's harder and harder to see hard copies of released exams. We, you know, security, we shouldn't be putting this stuff out there. So, right. Okay. So let's read these questions. Reading the questions, they give you time. The meter signature is most likely 2-4-4-4-6-8-9-8. Now, we have no idea what the music is. All of these are plausible. Except, right? 2-4 and 4-4 are both simple. Now, a duple, which we would conduct like that, a quadruple, which we would conduct like this, there's always a lot of gray area as to whether music is in 2-4 or 4-4, duple or quadruple, right? 1-2-3-4, 1-2-3-4, or 1-2-1-2, yes? Gray areas are great for discussion in class. Gray areas are not good for exam questions, which is to say that it's probably not very likely that those are going to be the answer choices. So then we can maybe expect to hear something in compound. Okay, compound duple, 6-8, 1 and 2 and 1 and 2 and, or compound triple. Those are conducting patterns. That looks like a banana, and this looks like a fancy boot. Right, so we want you to maybe conduct, I mean, not big, because, you know, there are other people taking the test and you don't want to do that, but that's the idea. Okay, now, question 10, which of the following best describes the form of the first section? There is a clue in just looking at the answer choices. What they're asking you to, well, what they're telling you, first of all, is that there's an introduction. There's an introduction. And then they're asking you to divide the rest in to four sections, probably phrases, maybe. Yeah, phrases. That is actually pretty hard when you're listening. Because when you're listening, you don't know, okay, am I here right now? Or am I here? Has this finished? Am I here? Wouldn't it be nice, like on YouTube or whatever MP3 player, there's a progress bar and there's a little dot that goes like this. Oh, I'm halfway through. I must be right here. That's handy. You get that? No. Are you rattled? No. Okay. So that kind of analysis. So this you might not get the first time, even though you only get to hear this once. But remember, you get to hear the entire excerpt later. Okay. So with that in mind, I'm going to play the first section. See if you can answer 9 and maybe an idea of what the phrasing structure is for 10. All right, here we go.
Now listen to the first section of the excerpt and answer questions 9 and 10.
And that's what you get. So hopefully, I don't know if you felt the same way. Like, I didn't know where in the progression of this we were at any one time, because I didn't know what the totality was, right? Is that even the right word? But I can answer this. Dum bum 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 bum. I heard bum 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 1 2 1 2. 6 8 compound duple. I'm going to tell you these numbers are 76% of students who took this exam got that question right. This one we still I don't know, right? But it's okay because we get to hear this again. All right, now the narrator is going to come back and say, before listening to the entire excerpt for the first time, entire excerpt, read questions 11 to 13. Question 11. Oh, by the way. Part of the strategy that these things are, you know, in a set is you don't necessarily have to answer these questions in order. Some of these questions are going to be easier than others, you know, softballs. You might look for those first and then kind of, okay, this is what I'm going with today kind of thing on the rest of them. That's okay. And that, again, that kind of strategy you don't get when you're not looking at question sets like this. Okay. Compared to the first section, the second section begins in the relative major, parallel major, subdominant, dominant. So you, first of all, you got to know what those terms mean. But secondly, what's important is compared to the first section, the second section begins in the. So you got to remember where the first section ended, and it's asking for that moment or those moments after that first section. So, right, that tonal memory where you were. Relative major is what? Major and minor keys that share the same key signature are relative, right? Which means the tonic, the do shifts. We were here, do, relative major would be the same key signature, the do shifts. Parallel major, major and minor keys that share the same tonic starting note. So we were in bum, ba, da, da, da. We're going to hear major. Ba, da, 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 da. Oh, I should have had you heard the music first. Subdominant is 4. That's a 4. What the what? That's a 4. Okay. 4. Dominant is 5. So if we were bum, ba would be there. Bum ba would be subdominant. Okay. Again, list, read the questions, build an expectation. That one is tough. 12. The excerpt is characterized by the use of syncopation, change in tempos, walking bass, pedal point. I hope that's big enough for you to see. That actually is more of a global question. It's not necessarily pertaining to it's the second section. So you can, maybe we can already answer that. I don't know. The texture of the entire excerpt. That's a global thing. Okay, so we're going to listen to the entire excerpt, but as I go, I'm going to try to give you clues here and then point out where exactly that. So that's the hardest thing about these, is exactly what moment are they talking about, right? These don't have moments. They're just globally everywhere. But questions like this, where, what are you referring to, right? And people that read questions or write questions like this, that's what they struggle with. How do we point the test taker to that one spot we want them to be? Okay, here we go. We're going to hear the whole thing, including what we've already heard.
Now listen to the entire excerpt for the first time and answer questions 11 through 13.
That's the intro. This is the first part we're listening to. That's the end of the first part. Same or contrasting? Same or contrasting? Similar to A or similar to B? Moment. And that's what you get. I do regret, while that was playing, I do regret that I didn't give you a chance to try to find that moment on your own. So I do apologize. Teacher, so we have a thing at school now. Teacher error. We put tally marks on the board. That was kind of a big one. I apologize. So having somebody lead you through that, it's not a hard question. But on the spot, that's a little tough. So the answer to that one was B. 75% students got it. So maybe that was not too bad. This one, the second section begins in that. Question 11 is what I'm talking about. So we had, what do we have? We started like this. And then it ended like this. What did it end like? And then we hear... Oops, teacher error number two, right? What happened? So we were here and then we went. Do, ti, la, so, so, fa, mi is the same do. It's parallel major. The excerpt is characterized by the use of. Well, we didn't hear a lot of syncopation. Syncopation would have been like something like that. What we heard was this forever. The whole A section, like through all this, which is an example of pedal. Texture? Hey, there are clues here if you weren't sure. The answer is B, but if you weren't sure, you could say, well, imitative polyphony is a type of melody with counter melody. The reverse doesn't work. Not all counter melodies are imitative, but that's kind of not mutually exclusive. Chances are not the answer, right? Okay, I'd like to do one more example. So that one wasn't too, so this was the hard one of the bunch, 33%, 40%, and texture was 84%. Excuse the mess on the screen if somebody just started watching here. All right, I'd like to do one more example. One more example. Okay, here we go. This one, we'll go faster. We'll go faster. We started a little bit late, but not that late. Started question 38 to 43 are based on an excerpt consisting of a short piano introduction and four phrases by cello. So this one too. Introduction, 1, 2, 3, 4. Intro, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's huge. The excerpt would be played four times before listening to the music. Please read. 38, a meter question again, right? Here's the thing about this one. I'm trying to speed this up. This simple triple and compound duple, like 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, or 1 and 2 and, depending on the hierarchy of where you identify the beat, they could apply to the same music, piece of music. Like if I went, I could be going 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, or I can be 1, 2, bum, ba, ba, da, da, da. They're both right. If they're both right, chances are we could probably eliminate those. Type of 6-4 chords. I hope you had a chance to study those. We at our school haven't got to those yet. We will. Cadential, neighbor, passing, arpeggiated. Melodic cadences, the melodic cadences at the end of phrases 1 and 2. So here's the thing. We have to listen for the end of phrase 1 and end of phrase 2. Again, that's difficult on the fly. Are decorated with a trill, an arpeggio, an escape tone, and anticipation. Phrase 3 ends with what kind of cadence? Authentic, plagal, half deceptive. Phrase 3 is lengthened by the means of. So maybe I should have drawn this thing to be longer there on 3. Repeated the opening motive, internal extension, modulating sequence, cadential extension. I believe the word modulating is no longer in the curriculum. Phrase 4 includes, this is an old example, which of the following? A deceptive progression, harmonic sequence, a Picardy third, imitation. Okay, so let's listen to this, and I'm going to, maybe I'll play it. I'm probably going to ask you to pause it and listen to it yourself first. Try to answer these questions, and then we'll talk. Here we go. Okay, I'm going to proceed with the answers. It'll be good. You get to hear this how many times? 4 times. So it'd be good if you just rewound the video. You can do that live too and join me for the answering part, okay? So now's the time to pause and rewind. Okay, meter. I'm hearing this. I'm not hearing. So I'm hearing simple duple. Simple duple. It might have been quadruple, but again, they don't ask you to discern that. The types of 6-4 chord for in phrase 1. So this overall getting the picture is difficult. But what we heard was this. That's the first phrase. So a cadential 6-4 is very possible. Would be we actually didn't get that. A neighbor 6-4 or a pedal 6-4 is where the bass doesn't change, right? Did we get that? If I just, so that's what it was. So the answer was B. A passing 6/4 is where the bass has the sound of a passing. That middle one would be a passing. So with apologies to the composer, a passing 6/4 would have been, right? One more time. That kind of thing. We didn't hear that. Arpeggiated 6/4 is where the bass, and when we reach that one, that's an arpeggio. So we would have been, what would that have been? That kind of thing. What we got was neighbor. Melodies at the end of the melodic cadence at the end of the phrase, marked by. Well, a trill is what? This is just a test if you knew the word. Right? An arpeggio would have been, what would it be? Sorry, Schubert composer. Escape tone would be, step away, leap down, or that's probably it. We didn't hear that. An anticipation gets there early, okay? Phrase three ends, how did it end? This is phrase three. That's the ending. Okay, that's the ending. That's a half cadence. And then the half cadence, I'm going to the next question. Half cadence is followed by. All that is so, just extending the last cadence. Okay, I wanted to have fun with this one, next one. But the last one, we hear this. What do we hear? Sorry. Predominant goes to dominant. We heard that. That's a deceptive. If we stop there, it's deceptive cadence. But we go, oh, we're not finished. And then we finish it. So deceptive progression. That one was tough. Okay. But the idea is these things happen in sets. And again, I'm giving you the answers because those are the right answers. Nobody's expecting you to get all the right answers. Box of chocolates, don't get rattled. Keep that image in your mind. Okay. So what should we take away? Well, the format of the test, you know, I've kind of walked you through what the first 45 minutes of the test is. If you know what to expect, then probably you could stay calmer, okay? Again, whatever you can get, just stay calm because this is a marathon. We still have a lot to go, okay? Next time on AP Daily Review Session Music Theory Edition.
Hi. Whoa, that's awkward. I'm right there.
I'm back tomorrow.
Hey, listen, tomorrow we're calling it a guided walkthrough of multiple choice questions part B. Part B are the questions that are non-aural, so there's no recording tomorrow. But you're looking at some scores and things and kind of fine print. So again, if you have a larger screen than your cell phone, that would be great. Also, some scratch paper might be good for doing analysis. All right, so I'll be here, same place, same time. Hope to see you then. Bye.
All right. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm going to say see you tomorrow. Hey, those of you that watch my videos in the fall, you know I have a thing going out and I have an improved version. Bye.